Hey guys, I thought I'd try something a little different today, so I'm going to record a VOD of a match I played earlier against a variant of lands. It's not like traditional lands. This one didn't seem to be, or maybe even have, depths. I was more focused on Field of the Dead, Uro, and I think it even had a couple of copies of Primeval Titan. But everything else was kind of traditional land space shell. But the games were kind of lengthy. It's a decent amount of interesting interactions, and I thought it'd be worth trying to cover it. And if this goes well, maybe I'll do some other matchups. So to start this match, we lost the roll on the draw in the dark, full land-based combo with a discard spell, with a needle for any potential combo pieces or lands-based answers. A second stage and a crop rotation. All we're kind of missing is green. It's not like a turn two hand, but it's still a very, very keepable hand in the dark. So we basically decide to keep this. The opponent has a very strong opening of their own here. So they start off with their main accel. Well, they have exploration too, but one of their main accelerants with Mox Diamond, plus a wasteland, which is great against us, and a Sylvan Library, which is also excellent against us. Because we're not really pressuring their life total at all. They're probably going to be able to draw 3 to 4 extra cards off of it without having to worry about dying. So this is kind of a devastating start to be playing against. So for our turn, we draw a Spirit Guide. Given that they have the Wasteland on board, we kind of want to cast the Thoughtseize before they can cast any crop rotations or any other devastating effect with it. So since they have no mana open, we definitely want to Urborg Thoughtseize. But we're probably also going to want a Spirit Guide Needle, because if they decide to snap off the Wasteland on Urborg, we have actual no color mana sources. So that's basically what we decide to do. So the Thoughtseize reveals Exploration Maze of Ith, Uro. In this case, the exploration could be really good, especially if they find a loam off of the Sylvan Library, but given that Maze of Ith is their only land, the exploration doesn't seem like it's something they can immediately leverage to devastating effect. And the Uro, on the other hand, they're one green or blue source away from being able to cast it for an extra 3 life, which in this matchup, when we have to get through Maze of Ith and multiple wastelands and probably Caracas and things like that, it's really difficult. We really don't want to have to hit them twice. They could pay enough life of Sylvan Library to offset that, but I really don't want them drawing an extra card with Uro and theoretically going over 20 if they decide that's the better play. So in this case, given that we have the answer to their wasteland already in hand with Pithing Needle, we have a crop rotation to theoretically answer the maze. I think Uro is the right call here. One of the key pieces to that decision is the fact that they only had one source of green or blue currently, which means they need to find 3 more sources before this becomes a card they can cast, which is going to be relatively difficult to do in the near term. So we take the Uro needle off the wasteland because, again, we can't afford to get the Urborg hit, and we'll have to see what happens when they basically more than likely recall themselves over the twice over the next 2 turns and see what we're dealing with. So in this case, they decide to pay the full 8 and draw 2 additional cards. So they play the exploration that we knew about, they play the maze that we knew about, and they play a cavern that was one of their 3 draws. So we draw a second stage, so or third stage actually. So here, I don't think we want to expose the depths to any kind of secondary land destruction spell, like if they have a Ghost Quarter or if Blast Zone gets our needle out of the way. So in this case, I think we just want to play the stage first and pass. On their turn, they pay the full 8 again to draw the 2 extra cards. So The downside, obviously, is they drew four extra cards. The upside is now the library isn't going to be quite as devastating, since they can't draw any more cards until Uro hits the table. So they play the Ghost Quarter, so now they have an answer to our combo. They also play a second end between the Cavern last turn and the Trop. They now have three colored sources towards the Uro, so that's also something we have to watch for. So for our draw step, we draw the Inquisition. We kind of want to see what else they've drawn into off the Exploration. Whenever we think that there's a possibility they have Crop Rot, we kind of want to force them to make a decision, and then we can plan around what they have, as opposed to, you know, trying to figure out what may be coming, since so many different cards can come off a Crop Rotation, whether it's Caracas, another Ghost Quarter, Mazebeth, I mean, who knows, even Glacial Chasm. There can just be a lot of Blast Zone, a lot of problem cards can come off of it. So in this case, we know, since they have the Ghost Quarter on board, we're not comboing anyway, so it's pretty free to just shoot off the Inquisition. So the only card we can take is a redundant Sylvan Library, which doesn't matter. Luckily, their other two cards are actually, they basically don't do anything in this spot, actually. They're not enough. They're missing the colored source for Uro still. The Wasteland's locked out by Needle, so even though the discard didn't hit anything relevant, it's still pretty good news, all things considered. So from here, we just play another stage. Again, no reason to expose the depths to their Ghost Quarter. And pass the turn. So their turn consists of the card they chose to keep off Sylvan Library. Of the three they looked at, was a second Ghost Quarter. So they're adding some layers of protection on that side, which is going to make it a little bit difficult going forward. So Spirit Guide's an interesting draw, because having that one extra mana can always be relevant and can set up some scenarios and plays that they may not be expecting. Like in this case in particular, we might be able to protect our lands with Crop Rotation without even having a green source in play. Again, we're not winning through the Ghost Quarters this turn, so I think the play is to just play yet another stage and pass, with the idea being that we'll start copying their Ghost Quarters at the end of their turn to try and put them to a decision of whether they want to give us some Ghost Quarters or whether they want to pop off our lands. Okay, so now the opponent actually has a clock. They played the Tomb that we knew about, leaving just a second Wasteland as their last card, and they played Field of the Dead, giving themselves a 2-2 zombie. So so now we have to actually find a window before the zombies just kill us from the Field of the Dead. So at this point, like we talked about, I think we just want to start copying their lands and see what they do. So in this case, they choose to go after the colored source. Our options here are to pitch Spirit Guide and Crop Rotation, but that doesn't make any sense to me, because we still can't win through their current Ghost Quarter and Maze on board. So I think we just let this happen, get the basic land off of the Ghost Quarter trigger. We're not really behind. Like, yes, the depths won't tap for mana for future turns unless we get another Urborg. But we're really not. We don't have a Hexmage. We're not going to be playing anything along those lines. So I think this is fine. We just let this happen. So we get a basic and untap. So we draw the Hexmage, which is kind of amusing. But I still don't really think we do anything here other than still we have to get through these this Ghost Quarter. So I think the plan again is to basically try and copy their Ghost Quarter again. Still don't want to play the depths because we don't want to expose it. they play the second Wasteland that we knew about. We try to copy their Ghost Quarter again. This time they Ghost Quarter our forest, which is a little different. We don't want to turn that into just a basic swamp. So at this point I do want to use the crop rotation. So the choice here is interesting. We could either take an Urborg and try and set up a combo that way with the Hexmage, but we currently got through their land destruction effects. So we kind of just need an answer to the Maze of Ith to win. One major consideration is that they kept a card off of the three that they saw with Sylvan Library and did not play a land. So given that they had Field of the Dead and another zombie would have changed the clock, it would have shaved a full turn off the clock, we can pretty much guarantee that that's not a land in their hand. So it had to be, my read would be that they kept a crop rotation or possibly an Abrupt Decay. So they can sit on the crop rotation and then blast zone our needle if we try to combo, or crop rotation into another Ghost Quarter or a Caracas, or they have many options as to what that could do. It's just hard to imagine a scenario where that's not a, that their top three had no lands and no reasonable cards that they couldn't play. So maybe it's something like an Abrupt Decay, but I don't think they have that kind of card main deck. So I think it's reasonable to come to the conclusion that they're probably holding a crop rotation. Given that, that means we're going to need to get through both whatever that gets and the Maze of Ith. So I don't think we have a choice but to basically grab the answer to the Maze of Ith. And if we have to sit here for a couple of turns to try and draw into something, whether to play through their crop rotation, whether that's a discard spell or, you know, some kind of answer base like a needle or a Nada's Word or something that can answer something coming from them at instant speed, I think we need the Ghost Quarter. And from here we can start copying our own Ghost Quarter with our own stages, and in a worst case scenario that can get us to black mana by Ghost Quartering one of our own lands and fetching out the basic swamp if it comes to it. So we do draw the discard spell. We're clearly not going to Ghost Quarter ourselves now. So what we can do from here is threaten the combo with the Ghost Quarter for their Maze of Ith on the off chance they play their last card. We have it on board, still with the option to, at the end of their turn, copy the Ghost Quarter. Ideally, we would just draw a black source to be able to cast this duress to know for sure what the play or what we're dealing with. Okay, so at the end of their turn, we copy the Ghost Quarter. Nothing happens, they just allow it to happen. So the plus side here, so we do draw the black source so we can see what's in their hand. The plus side here is we have, there's no way for us for them to kill us here. Even if they have crop rotation, there's a couple of different ways they can get to exactly six zombies. Either fetch off Misty Rainforest and then crop into a fetch and fetch, that gives them six zombies, or they can just crop into a second Field of the Dead, which gives them one, and then fetch to give them two more. So they can get to 12 power. So if we can threaten a 20-20, we don't die to this swing no matter what they do. And we have the availability to Ghost Quarter twice and still have the combo up and have it be kind of hidden because the spirit guide's in hand. So every time, every We have a lot of options this turn, but it all starts with the duress to try and see if their read is correct, that they probably did have crop rotation. So the last card was the crop rotation. They grab Field of the Dead. So, or not Field of the Dead, I'm sorry. They grab Blast Zone. So that puts us into a position where if they ever get to pop the Blast Zone, when we don't have the ability to combo with it on the stack, it blows up the needle and then they have two active wastelands. So we kind of just pass the turn here because we can't necessarily, we don't want to necessarily initiate on our own turn. So here they're exactly 2 points short off the zombies. So what we want to do is force them to pop their blast zone with one ghost quarter. And then when they do that, we can ghost quarter the Maze of Ith and then activate the stage to copy the depths. And as long as their last card isn't another crop rotation, we're probably good. So we ghost quarter the blast zone. They activate the blast zone. We ghost quarter the maze before the wastelands are active. And then we use the spirit guide to copy the depths. And luckily that is good enough for this particular game. They did not find a second maze, or a second crop rotation, I should say. So, game two, we're also on the draw. So, this hand is a little on the slow side for the lands matchup. Ideally, you would have something that pressures them early. I think this is still a keep because it has a lot of the key components that we would need to win. So, we have Needle for Wasteland or Ghost Quarter. We have Knot of this World and Safekeeper for Maze of Ith, Caracas, those kinds of cards. We have Bog if they try to get Loam going early, and then we have the crop rotation, which is basically the best card in the matchup. So it's not fast, but it's got a lot of play to it, so I think it's reasonable to keep this hand. So the opponent starts on Ghost Quarter Go. So it's interesting because the Ghost Quarter is fine. We can freely just fetch a Bayou and cast the Needle here, because if they ghost quarter the Bayou, that just exchanges it for a forest, which I'm fine with. So they allow that to happen. We Needle the ghost quarter. On their second turn, they Mox Diamond into Wasteland, so they still have an answer to the combo and an Accelerant. They pitched a second ghost quarter, so Needle was kind of helpful, even though it's not breaking us through entirely. So that was a perfect draw, is a turn two Leyline of the Void. From here we could play the Safekeeper. It's kind of iffy whether you want to. It kind of plays into Blast Zone by having two one drops on the table, and it's not really a clock, even though it pecks away a little bit. So on this particular turn, I could go either way with it. I think if I had to do it again, I would probably play it, but in this particular game, I chose to keep crop rotation up instead to protect the green source. So the opponent on their second or third turn plays Exploration, a second Wasteland, and a Windswept Heath. So the opponent has a lot of protection. So at this point, I just decide I have to start developing the board a little bit. So I play out the Safekeeper, play out the Bog. They fetch into a Breeding Pool. So interesting spot there is they decided on their turn to try and cut us off green entirely with the Wasteland. I don't know how I feel about that play in general. I think the lands players are generally in better shape if they just hold off on their Wastelands, and if we don't draw Pithing Needle or multiple stages, it's really hard to get through more than one Wasteland. But in this case, they just go for the angle to try and cut us off of green and see what happens. We could have saved it with Spirit Guide plus Crop Rotation, but similar to the first game, I don't think we want to be... the Spirit Guide hidden mana is very valuable and was basically the reason we won the first game, and the Crop Rotation is the most valuable card in the matchup, so I don't think we want to be using that to rotate, using two of our resources to exchange a Bayou for another land to counter their Wasteland when they have another Wasteland on board, because they could just take care of whatever we grab even if necessary. So from here, we get kind of fortunate and draw another Bayou. It's time to we have a 19 turn clock, so we've got that going for us. But the only other options that turn were hard casting the Spirit Guide, or you could even pitch the Spirit Guide to play the Ley Line of the Void. But given that they have a Wasteland in their graveyard already that they could bring back and another Wasteland in play already, I didn't want to spew the Elvish Spirit Guide just to get the Ley Line into play. So I elected not to copy their Wasteland end step, because I thought that they would again just snap off the Wasteland, which wouldn't be the greatest spot for us as far as colored mana goes, so I elected not to do that. There is the argument for doing it, and if they hit our green again, we have the ability to combo with Depth Stage, Bog, Spirit Guide. But given that they've held a couple of cards for a couple of turns in a row, it kind of feels like very similar to game one. It's likely that they have a Crop Rotation or maybe some like Force of Vigor type card for the needle to open back up the Ghost Quarter. So they pass again. At the end of their turn, I tried to stage their Wasteland because now we have two stages. So if they want to cut us off green, I'm actually okay with that. So they did try to Wasteland the Bayou to not allow us to have a copy of the Bayou. So at this point, I think it's worth rotating for a couple of reasons. One, given that we have the Spirit Guide in hand, on our following turn, we can play the Depths, which gives us double stage, Urborg, Depths, Bog, which with the hidden Spirit Guide in hand again, actually allows us to go for it twice. So if we pass to them after our following turn, assuming we draw nothing relevant, we would have the ability to like tap Urborg, Depths, and the first stage to copy the Depths. And if they say Crop Rotation for Wasteland, we can use the last stage, the Bog, and the Spirit Guide in hand to copy again. So we can make a 20/20 through a Crop Rotation into a land destruction effect. If they elect to go for a Crop Rotation into an answer base like a Caracas, we have the Knot of this World and we have the Safekeeper. So this line allows us to beat a Crop Rotation on the following turn. So we draw a Thoughtseize for the turn. So this is probably a conservative line. And I don't know that I would normally recommend people trying to beat two Crop Rotations out of someone's hand. But for some reason, I had the read that it was either Crop Rotation plus Force of Vigor or double Crop Rotation, because I just couldn't figure out what they wouldn't have played out on previous turns. The only other card that would make sense is like a Primeval Titan. So the thought process was, if they have, you know, a card like Titan or Force of Vigor, they can't actually beat us with Force of Vigor, given that they would only have one untapped land, and we can combo through that. So by not discarding spell, like not casting a discard spell, we would lose the double crop rotation. And I decided that given the resources that I had, that I thought it was an unacceptable risk to lose to them, that being a possibility. So in response to the Thoughtseize, they do have the double crop rotation. So they get Blast Zone and Wasteland. So this is awkward for a couple of reasons. It's very similar to game one. The needle, or the Blast Zone, not only answers the needle, but it also answers the Sylvan Safekeeper. So luckily they have no hand, so the Safekeeper is not much of a loss because we have the Knot of this World to handle anything. However, the Blast Zone is a problem. So basically all we can do for this turn is hit them for one and put them into a spot where they can't, because they only had four mana, so they couldn't tap three in the Blast Zone to pop it without us being able to combo. So they have to untap. They draw another Blast Zone for their turn, which is kind of unfortunate because now they have enough mana to have Wasteland active, have Blast Zone active, and then behind it have Ghost Quarter active. And we don't really have much recourse for that. We also can't, from this position, we don't have enough mana to copy anything with stage and not open ourselves up to this, to them just activating Blast Zone and turning their Ghost Quarter back up. So we have to let the end of step, we have to go through their end step and draw. So here we draw a Sylvan Scrying, which is not great. So the best course is to just hit them for one and try to pass the turn. So they play that very well there, and that they didn't try to, even though they have two Blast Zones, they didn't try to activate one, because we do have the hidden mana, so we would have been able to combo twice through it. So very heads up play by the opponent to just sit on these Blast Zones for now, and see what happens. So here we draw a Thoughtseize, but that doesn't do anything because they have absolutely no hand. So we just swing in for one. Same situation as last turn. They kind of picked up on the fact that they don't have to do anything. Now they played a Field of the Dead, so you know, even different lands that they draw are going to eventually get a clock. So here we draw a Hexmage. So we can continue to play this game where we pass with mana up, but they're getting close to the point where they can actually just Blast Zone and have another Blast Zone up with multiple Ghost Quarters up. So we're kind of in a bad situation. So the choice is to just try and draw into Needle or some other way to force our combo through, like our own Ghost Quarter or something, to force them to do something. Or we can try and actually kill them from 14, as unlikely as that sounds, given that they have five different lands, a Field of the Dead, and two Blast Zones. But I think all of it starts, I think we kind of have to just play a Hexmage here and see what they decide to do after we attack for one, and start to put some pressure on them. So when we play the Hexmage, they Wasteland the Dark Depths. So there's no way for us to combo there. If we combo there, they just pop the Blast Zone and then Ghost Quarter. So we just let that go. From there, they pop the Blast Zone anyway, which sweeps up, does hit their exploration, but it sweeps up both our Needle and our Safekeeper. So now they have both Ghost Quarters unlocked. So the good part about them using the wasteland is they were still a couple of turns away from Field of the Dead being a relevant card. So at the end of their turn, just to have some actual green mana, we copy their forest. They don't Ghost Quarters. I don't know that it would have made a difference if they Ghost Quartered us. We get our basic forest anyway. So I think that was also the correct play to just not do anything on their side. So from here, we're basically just basically trying to clock them, which is probably a losing battle, but something you want to try. So they put the second counter on Blast Zone, which is good for killing our Hexmage whenever they feel like it. So from here, it's probably not going to do a lot of good, but besides attacking, I think we want to play as much of our hand as possible. So I think we want to play the ley line. It's already going to be devastating if they hit a loam, but at least it'll only allow it to happen once. So for here, I think we just swing out, we play the ley line, and then we play the safekeeper. So they do draw the loam, which is pretty devastating. So they end up getting a 2/2 zombie into play and wastelanding our second stage. So we draw a step, which is an interesting card because if we do manage to get them low enough, the last creature could go through their blockers. So here they wisely just trade off their first zombie. From there, I think the best path for us to win this game is just with random creature beats. So use the scrying to tutor for Ghost Quarter to get rid of their Field of the Dead, which gets exiled due to the ley line. So they already have the Hexmage on lockdown with the Blast Zone, but it's technically a 4-turn clock with the Safekeeper, the last turn of which they can't block because of the step in our hand. So it's not a 0% chance that we could just win by a beatdown. However, their draw step for this turn was Primeval Titan, which is basically unbeatable from this board state. So they get a second Field of the Dead and another wasteland, and from there that kind of just locks the game up. But these games are interesting because I feel like in the first game, if they had just drawn something really good off of their last three looks off Sylvan Library, which was post-shuffle because of my Ghost Quarter, they would have won that game. And I feel like there were multiple turns in this game where I was one top deck away, or them not drawing the loam in that one last window, may have been able to get there with the beats. Like, I feel like despite the fact, like, a lot of people think that the like depth shells have to play fast against these style lists, but I don't find that the games play out that way all the time. Like, you can and do have very competitive games versus all kinds of draws on their side, as long as you can as long as you can keep their value engines from going to town. So if you can keep them off Uro or normally Life in the Loam, those kind of cards, you can kind of extend the game out a little bit and still have a fighting chance. I feel like, their deck won through a lot in this game. They had a couple of crop rotations too. I feel like my deck won through a lot in the first game. And I just find these matchups to be really intricate, and there's a lot of play to them, and both decks are working off of the other deck's cards, which I find particularly interesting. I like being able to use Thespian Stage and work off their Ghost Quarters and Wastelands and various other cards. If you guys are wondering how the match ended up turning out, in game three, a significantly less interesting game where I led off with Bayou Safekeeper, where I had Crop Rotation, Needle, Hexmage, Depths, and I forget what the last card was. And They started off with Wasteland, Wasted by Bayou, and I never drew another green source. So there are those games too, where just their Mana Denial and Destruction Plan works. But yeah, I found a couple of these games interesting enough that I thought it was worth talking through some of my thought process. So if you guys enjoyed this, let me know. If not, I can always just never do one again. All right, thanks.